Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
I'm going to talk about the capacity and fairness issues which arise in enterprise-class wireless mesh networks and how I propose to solve those issues. So the motivation of my talk is twofold. I probably shouldn't be giving this motivation slide to this audience, but I'll give it anyways. So first is we want to come up with what we call truly wireless enterprise network. In today's enterprise wireless LAN deployment, only the access point to mobile client communication is wireless. The access points themselves are interconnected using a comprehensive wired backbone, which also connects them to the enterprise computing resources. This wiring requirement not only complicates the deployment, but also limits the number of access points you can place. And specifically, if you want to do an outdoor campus-wide wireless LAN deployment, this could become a major problem. So what we want to do is come up with an architecture which gets rid of most, if not all, of these wires. And the second motivation of my talk is to come up with an alternative ISP last mile networking technology. Today, there are a bunch of alternatives to anybody. One is 3G, which suffers from high spectrum and infrastructure cost. That gets reflected in the high customer bills, which they have to pay per unit of bandwidth. The cable and DSL suffer from some of the problems, that is fixed asymmetric division of bandwidth, and also the limited availability. And broadband over power line has the problem that of RF interference, which is why it has seen a limited deployment. And it's an upcoming technology at this point. So what you want to do is provide another last mile ISP networking technique, which can be used for the networking part. So one promising way to solve this problem is to use what we call a wireless mesh network. In short, a wireless mesh network is a multi-hop ad hoc network of static wireless routers. Here, these are the mobile clients and this is the access point. So this communication stays as it is. However, the communication between access points and with the enterprise computing resources, which is sitting on a small core wired network, is done using wireless links. Specifically, if nodes are close to each other, they can talk directly. If nodes are far away, they will use intermediate nodes as routers to exchange information. Now, this architecture is based on the MANET architecture, the Mobile Ad Hoc Network architecture, and it inherits some of the features such as self-configurability and self-healing properties. This wireless mesh network is going to be the focus of our talk today. So let me go over some of the problems which we face in this wireless mesh network and what are some of the contributions I have made in this direction. The first problem that we face is that of network capacity. We will see why the network capacity problem comes in. And what I have done here is I have proposed a multi-channel mesh networking architecture and proved that it can actually increase the bandwidth of a mesh network manifold. And I have proposed a distributed channel assignment and routing algorithm which actually achieves that performance improvement. The second problem that comes up in a mesh network is that of bandwidth utilization and fair distribution of bandwidth across flows. Towards this end, I have proposed a stateful transport protocol and a coordinated congestion control, and I'm going to talk about them as well. The third problem that I'm currently working on is the problem of how do we make sure that when some of the nodes in the network are compromised, they cannot bring down the entire network. As things stand now, once a node is compromised, if you are able to modify the software which is running on the node, then you can pretty much bring down the entire network if the protocol does not take care of this. And cryptography alone is not a solution to this problem. So what I'm looking at is how to utilize redundant computation across the network to make the protocols resilient to such compromised routers. Next, there was a based on all our work here, we figured out that there is a lack of an experimentation platform and for doing mesh networking research. And what we did was we proposed a miniaturized wireless network testbed. In fact, we built a 12-node wireless network testbed, which is miniaturized. It can sit in a small room, and it can be reconfigured on an experiment-by-experiment basis. And I'm going to talk briefly about that. Finally, I've done some work in wireless mesh networking applications. Specifically, I'll come up with a system which allows users like us to build an instant, secure, ad hoc network and perform file sharing and application sharing on top of it. Secondly, I have worked with other people on securing an enterprise wireless LAN by using securing and managing the radio resource of an enterprise by using a wireless mesh network as the backbone. And finally, I've done some work on, I'm working on some of the cross-layer video delivery techniques. So the focus of this talk will be on the first two aspects, and I'll go briefly into the experimentation platform. Okay, so here's the outline of my talk. First, we already discussed the scenarios and contributions. I'm going to talk about the multi-channel mesh networking, the research issues that come therein, and the problem of load balancing, routing, and channel assignment. Next, I'll talk about the stateful transfer protocol, specifically the two congestion control mechanisms that I have proposed. Finally, I'll talk about the Mint evaluation platform, that is the miniaturized testbed that I use for all this work, and before concluding the talk. So let's look at what is the capacity problem first. The big problem in mesh network is that as things stand now, or at least as things stood when I started doing this research, was that if you build a mesh network, everybody would be talking over the same channel. And this is necessary because everybody has to keep themselves connected to the network. And what that does is it leads to massive intra-flow and inter-flow interference. For example, in this simple mesh network that I've drawn, when link from 3 to 4 is active, none of the links that are shown can be active at the same time. Why? Because these three nodes fall in the hearing range of 3. However, 1, 9, 11, and 5 fall in the sense range of 3. And 6 and 12 fall in the sense range of 4. What that does is, once you're sending a packet over link 3 to 4 only, that link can be active, nothing else. In fact, at most 3 links can be active at a time in this network. And in a typical case, 2 links would be active. All this problem comes in because everybody is working on the same channel. So to solve this problem, I have proposed this multi-channel mesh networking architecture. And the essential idea is to reduce interference by using multiple channels. What you can call is topology control through use of multiple channels. There have been past work in this direction, and most of them has been geared towards how to modify the MAC layer to utilize multiple channels effectively. However, that not only requires modifications to the hardware, it also requires modification to the protocol. And what I propose here is that we use a router which has multiple radios, similar to the work which a lot of you have done here, and then use traffic-aware channel assignment and routing algorithms to fully utilize the potential of that architecture. So in this case, this is the same picture as earlier, except that each node now has, instead of one wireless card, it has two wireless cards. So it can communicate over two channels simultaneously. So this node is communicating to these two over channel 4 and these two over channel 2. However, the network as a whole can communicate over several channels. And what we are able to do, essentially, if we are able to do this, then we are able to reduce the interference which occurs between these links and essentially bump up the capacity by making multiple links active at the same time. And for this talk, I'm going to work with this metric called cross-section goodput. What is the cross-section goodput? It's essentially the... this part is talking about the capacity which is available between any access point and these wired gateways. So I'm saying that most of the traffic in a practical wireless mesh network would be between access point and the core wired network. because everybody is trying to get to the internet or to enterprise computing resources. So this is the capacity which is available from any node, any access point to the ith gateway. Sum it up. So the aggregate capacity from a node to the wired network, and upper bounded by the bandwidth requirement of the access point. That is, we don't want to allocate more capacity than is needed on a particular node. And so now there are two problems in this. First is, how do you do the routing across this multi-channel, multi-radio wireless mesh network? And secondly, there is the problem of how do you assign channels to these links? So the first problem is that of load balancing routing. Here the problem, what we have is, what we have these nodes here, and some of these are access, some of these are gateways. They can connect this mesh network to the wired network. And what you want to do is, we want to connect each node in this network back to the wired network by potentially using multiple hops. The number on each node is showing the amount of traffic that it is generating in either direction. And we want to connect each node to the wired network through feasible paths. What do I mean by feasible paths? I cannot have this node with load 30 connect to the green gateway because none of its neighbors are connecting to the green gateway. So essentially, there is interdependency between nodes, between the paths which are used by the nodes. If I have, if none of my neighbors connect to a certain gateway, I cannot do that either. And an observation is that as we go further and further up, closer to the wired network, closer to the wired gateways, there is more and more aggregation happening. So most of the load is aggregated over here. So most of the load balancing that we, yes.
You said that your strategy was that if none of my neighbors, if my neighbors are connected to a particular gateway, then I connect that particular gateway.
I can connect to that particular gateway.
Yeah, okay.
So but if the neighbors, yes.
Node 50, for example,
correct.
Like 10 is also is possible.
Yes. Okay. So and that is what we have to decide. How do we decide?
And the restriction of making sure that I can only talk to the gateway that my neighbor, that all my neighbors talk to, is that. Is that a restriction due to implementation, or is that more of a fundamental?
It's a fundamental restriction. I cannot talk to, I cannot, because I'm forming a multi-hop network, I have to have somebody in my neighborhood talking to who I want to talk to.
So it's not the issue of whether my neighbors can reach the gateway. It's more, is it an issue of whether my neighbors can reach the gateway, or which gateway, if they can reach multiple ones, they have decided to go with?
It depends. Yeah, the second one. It's more about which gateways they have decided to go with. So fundamentally, it's true that if it's possible that I can decide to go to a certain gateway, even though none of my neighbors decide to go to that gateway. However, as we'll see later in the next slide, it actually becomes a problem that if none of my neighbors is willing to talk to a certain gateway. That is, it has formed its, it has assigned the channels and its routes in such a way that it is not talking to a certain gateway, then it would be hard for me to reach that gateway as well, just because of the channel assignment constraints.
That makes the channel assignment problem easier. Right?
Yes.
That is a fundamental
issue. Not that is a fundamental problem, right. Sorry.
And you would never have a situation where there are two red gateways nearby, so that, for example, node 30 could have picked either one.
Actually, that's not true, because in fact, it is actually a more likely scenario that I would put multiple gateways close to each other, just because I'm already pulling a wire to that area.
But on the same channel or not?
That's probably on a different channel.
Ah, okay. That's
yeah. But since I'm already pulling a wire to that area, I might as well put multiple gateways there, or at least several radios on the gateway, effectively multiple gateways. Okay, so this problem can be, one way to formulate this problem is as a, so what we want to do is we want to balance the loads across the gateway nodes, because that's where most of the aggregation is happening. I don't want one gateway to be too much loaded as compared to other gateway. And one can formulate this problem as a multi-level bin packing problem, where I'm essentially assigning these items to these bins. However, I cannot assign any item to any bin arbitrarily, because I have this constraint that at least one of my neighbors had to be assigned to that bin as well. And so here what we are saying is each node finds a parent from its neighbors such that the eventual load, which is aggregated load on the gateways, it's well balanced. That's all we are saying here. Yes?
Is this
the optimal formulation, or is this just a formulation?
This is a formulation, I would say.
Okay.
Okay. So, to address this problem in a distributed manner, I use this 802.1D like gateway discovery protocol. Essentially, each node joins the subnetwork of one or more gateways. And in this talk, we'll focus on the case where each node joins only one gateway. And when a node joins a certain gateway, that is, this, for example, this 20 joined red gateway using the node with load 30, then it is forming a parent-child relationship between the two. And what we end up is we end up with a structure which is essentially a forest of trees, where each tree is rooted at a gateway node. Okay, and a node can receive advertisements from other gateways as well, which are not part of the tree. For example, 50 could receive advertisement from 40, but for this talk, we'll focus on the case where it is just caching that advertisement for failure recovery, rather than actively using it. Yes.
I guess maybe. You just answered that, but it says one or more, and are you saying that for the purpose of this talk, it's just one?
Yes.
Okay.
For this talk, we'll focus on the case when it is only one. Okay, so the actual distribution of nodes across the gateways or the eventual paths which are chosen, it depends on the load, it depends on the metric that we use. So, for example, in this case, if we use the hop count to gateway metric, we end up with this structure because this is essentially the structure which we would end up with, and the red gateway would be much more loaded than the green one. The other possibility is to use the residual capacity on the gateway nodes, the wired and the wireless links of the gateway nodes. That is here and here. And in that case, the node with load 50 would end up joining the green gateway. And the third possibility is we actually go ahead and we look at the path residual capacity. That is, when a node joins a certain gateway, it looks at along the entire path, what are the links, what is the most bottleneck link, and what is the capacity available on that. And in this case, the node with load 20 would end up joining this part of the subtree as compared to that one. Yes.
So this is kind of abstract because it doesn't really tell me how you're going to calculate any of those numbers.
Correct.
Do you want to postpone all questions about how it to later in the talk about like how these mechanisms work?
Actually, that could be better.
Okay.
Yes. I mean, I can go into those details right now, but that would be better. Okay. So this is one way to solve a problem in a distributed manner. Essentially, each node is able to find a path to the wired network, and it's solving it's doing something. Essentially, either it's optimizing the hop count, or either it's doing a load balancing across the gateways, or making sure that no individual link in the path is heavily loaded. Okay, and I'm working on the aspect where we are trying to do a more optimal distribution of nodes across the gateways, and that's more of a centralized algorithm. And I won't talk about that here either. So, the second problem is that of channel assignment. Here, what we want to do is we want to assign radio channel to each link. And what we are given is the traffic load on the links. That is, for each link, we are given the traffic load, and we want to come up with a channel assignment. And from capacity standpoint, the whole sole goal of channel assignment is to assign capacity such that the individual link capacity matches the traffic load which is imposed on the link. When I assign the same channel to multiple links in a neighborhood, then the individual available capacity to each one of them would be reduced. So a link which has to carry more traffic, I want to assign it a channel which is least used by the neighbors. Okay, and vice versa. I can do the other thing as well. So, and the constraints I have is the number of interfaces per node. I cannot assign. For this node, for example, if I have two interfaces, I can only assign two channels. I cannot assign more than two channels. So, This essentially is a sort of a constrained edge coloring problem. And what we want to do is, we are given a whole bunch of parameters. We are given the traffic load of the links, the number of radio channels, radios on each node, and the channel capacity. And we are given the interference relationship between between individual links, which links interfere with each other links. And we want to come up with a channel assignment for the links such that the number of colors, number of channels incident onto any node is limited by the number of radios it has. And if you take any click in the network, which is essentially an interference zone, and project it onto a particular channel, then it should not exceed the channel capacity. But at the end of the day, what we are doing, in simpler words, what we are doing is we are trying to do a capacity assignment to the links. All the links might not be active simultaneously.
You might decide that two links interfere, therefore you could assign them separate channels. Uh-huh. But there might not be, because of the traffic pattern, mm-hmm. might not be active simultaneously.
Yes, that is true. So what we are essentially saying is that, as far as the click is concerned, any link in that is active, then the channel is utilized in that click.
Sure, but two things, right? First of all, it might not utilize the channel fully.
Uh-huh.
And so, all I'm saying is that there's a timing aspect here, too. I mean, the assumption that you have made seems pessimistic, that's all.
I see. So as far as the click is concerned, it's as long as one link becomes active, the channel gets utilized already.
20% of the time, then what?
No, when I say active, I'm talking about the actual...
When it is active,
not in general active or not active. I'm talking about if it is active 20% of the time and another link in that same interference zone is active 80% of the time, then we have the channel fully utilized. Okay, so... So to solve this channel assignment problem, I exchange information between neighbors or between interference range neighbors as to what are the channels which they are using, and how much is the utilization of each channel, and come up with what we can call a neighborhood channel usage map. That is, each node knows what is the utilization of individual channels across the entire neighborhood, and then it does a reassignment of channels to its interfaces so as to balance the load across the channels. So I figure out how much each channel is utilized, and I figure out the least used channel, and I'm going to assign those channels to my interfaces. So the point is that I cannot just blindly assign channels to all my interfaces, because I have to coordinate this channel assignment with my neighbors. Okay, and that is the... So you can actually skip this part for now, but let's look at this part, channel dependency issue. So for example, in this case here, it may happen that node D, for example, node D and F figures out that this link is operating over channel 3 and this channel is no good. Let's switch from channel 3 to, let's say, channel 7. Okay, I've written it here, but yeah. Let's say they decide to change from channel 3 to channel 7. What will end up happening is the number of interfaces constrained on node D would be violated, because it's now using 3 channels instead of 2. So it has to switch the channel of this link as well, either this link or this link, these two links. Let's say it changes the channel of this link from 3 to 7 as well. Then that leads to a number of interface constraint violation on node E as well, which has to change its channel and so on. So in this case, what can end up happening is when a particular pair of nodes decide that channel 3 is no good, and they switched from channel 3 to channel 7, it can lead to a ripple effect across the entire connected component. And everybody who is operating on channel 3 might switch to channel 7. And essentially, it leads to nowhere. And so this channel dependency is the key thing which we have to break in some sense. And to break this channel dependency, I utilize the tree structure of the network. Utilize the fact that everything is operating as essentially a forest of trees. And this is where the simplification of this comes into picture, that we are actually able to utilize the tree structure for something more than just that. So the way it works is each node uses a different set of channels to talk to its parent as compared to talking to its children. So it takes its interfaces, it divides it into two sets. One is called upnic and one is downnic. Upnic is dedicated to talk to the parent, and downnic is dedicated to talk to children. And the channel of the downnic is decided by the node itself. So A will decide the channel assignment of these two. However, the channel of the upnic will be decided by the parent. So in this case, what we are able to do is we are able to independently do a channel assignment on every node and just coordinate it with one hop neighbors and essentially break the channel dependency. And this can lead to, the one problem that this can lead to is that a node may not have a common channel with some of its neighbors because they are neither parent nor children. So one possibility is to have an optional control NIC, or the other possibility is to use the fact that these nodes are anyway connected via the wired network. So they have a multi-hop connectivity regardless, and use that. And that's what I call as virtual control channels. And in terms of channel load, how do you determine? So that's the other part which I skipped earlier. The channel load metric. It's related to what Jitu was asking, that how do you define what is, whether a channel is loaded or not loaded. So one possibility is I just look at the number of nodes which are operating in the same channel within my interference range. Or the other possibility is I actually look at the channel usage and sum it up. So if one, and then use that as the measure of how much the channel is utilized. Yes?
The tree structure seems to constrain your network to sort of, I mean, basically you're only sort of permitting communication between the ITAP and the nodes directly, I mean, rather than peer-to-peer communication among nodes.
Yeah, and we are optimizing it for that case only, because that's what we believe is the primary case to optimize.
If you wanted to talk to N2, you have to go up to the ITAP.
Yes. Yes. Yeah.
What exactly is aggregated channel usage? Is it defined at a particular location, or is it defined for the network?
No, it's defined at a particular location.
So channel usage is independent for different nodes.
Yes. So if you can look at it as, from this node standpoint, I have all these channels, and how much do I see the channels as, if I were to put one card of mine onto in the promiscuous mode and observe the channel, then how much do I see the channel is free
so
or utilized?
If I don't have any on that channel, mm-hmm. I have to like switch for, I don't know, a few seconds to measure channel usage or something like that?
That's one possibility, or the other possibility is I exchange information with others who are using the channel.
That's not a possibility, right? Because it's defined at only at a given point.
Yes.
Space. So, mm-hmm. I don't know.
So ideally, okay, it's true that ideally I want to actually switch to that channel and look at the usage of the channel. But another way to do it is that I say that, okay, I interfere with these two other nodes, and I ask them how much are they using the channel, and get an approximation of that by summing up their channel usages. I mean, that's an approximation. It's not, at the end of the day, all we are looking for is how to compare channels. We are not looking for actual number of the channel. I mean, actual utilization number doesn't matter to us, really speaking. What we really care about is the relative utilization.
Well, since the approximation is not bounded on one side, even the comparison is basically an approximate comparison.
Yes. Yeah. That's right.
I guess the other question is, it seems now that you also have this dependency on determining those neighbors that you interfere with, which does that not lead to having to switch your NIC again?
I'm sorry, I think I didn't get the question.
It seems that there's some neighbor discovery step that for people who are off your channel that you've reintroduced. Even if you go to the control channel for the purpose of the virtual control channel for the purposes of measuring the utilization at a small granularity, mm-hmm. at some fine granularity, at some coarser granularity, you still want to know who those neighbors are that you interfere with.
Yes.
Does that reintroduce the polling problem, the having to switch your NIC and poll?
Let me think about what you said. So my neighbor discovery part is going to be separate. It's going to be done at the as a separate step from this all this channel assignment.
Okay.
And even my interference range neighbor discovery is going to be done as a separate step.
When is that done?
So when a new node comes up, it does this interference. It does both this communication range neighbor discovery and interference range neighbor discovery.
But if the other nodes are on different channels, so
yeah. So it actually scans all the channels. Yes. So I go on every single channel which is there, and figure out who are my neighbors on each of the channels.
And I only do this once when I join.
Ideally, we should do it periodically.
There's still a circular problem here. Suppose Dave's my neighbor and Dave is not speaking at all on channel 2. How do I know Dave is my neighbor on channel 2?
No, because at the time I'm going to come up, I'm going to initialize the node. At the time you get initialized, you will scan all the channels and figure out that Dave is your neighbor.
Oh, so the assumption is if Dave is my neighbor on channel 1, he's my neighbor on all channels.
He is your physical neighbor, but he's not necessarily your radio neighbor. Is what I would say.
The difference
is? Okay, so it may be the case. Okay, so what you want to figure out is whether Dave is your neighbor or not. You want to figure that out because you want to see whether you want to use the same channel as Dave is using or not. So you have to have this information to begin with. And to infer this information, what you're going to do is you're going to scan all the channels and figure out whether you are.
Is neighborhood defined per channel, or do you assume that the neighborhood? Or the neighbor relationship is basically the independent of the channel, which basically
means over channels. Neighbor on any channel means neighbor on all channels.
Okay. Because at the time I do the channel assignment, I have to ensure that I use the channels appropriately.
That's true. I'm only worried about different levels of interference on different channels. So Dave may be my neighbor on channel 1, but he may not be my neighbor on channel
2. Yes. In that is true. That is an approximation we are doing here.
Are there TCP effects that screw up your channel usage estimation? So, for instance, I have a flow that's going cross protocol POPs, and because there's congestion much later on, I'm not fully utilizing the local channel that I would have done had there not been congestion multiple hops later.
Yes.
So my current estimate of channel usage
would depend on what you are actually using.
Redo all of your channel assignment and all of a sudden I'm using a lot more or maybe even a lot less.
Yeah, so when your traffic changes based on let's say currently TCP flow is congested at some other location. And based on that, there is a limited usage on this particular link, then that's what whatever the actual usage is at this point is what you would consider to be the channel usage. And later on, it may change that the link which was originally the bottleneck is no longer the bottleneck.
Right, but that might change as a result of your channel assignment, right? So there's a tight control loop there, right? A feedback loop there, right?
It may happen because of, right, that is, you're saying, but we are essentially what we are doing is we are isolating the channel assignment of individual location, right? That's what we have done here. So, okay. Sorry, you have a question?
No.
Okay. All right. So, here are some performance evaluation. Some performance evaluation are based on the simulations, and then I have done some testbed evaluation as well. So here, what I have is 60 nodes with 4 gateway nodes. Each node is equipped with 2 interfaces, and there are 12 available channels. And I pick 30 nodes at random and send the traffic from the node to the wired network. And essentially, here are the results. So what I have shown here is the topology ID, which is essentially the experiment ID, which corresponds to a randomly chosen topology and traffic profile. And so on the y-axis I have the network cross-section goodput, which is the sum of available useful bandwidth I have in the entire network. And this is the measurement for the single channel. Another possibility is that I have this whole network, and I take individual trees and operate them on different channels without using multiple interfaces. And that's what this one NIC multi-channel thing is. And that's actually what Tropos uses, which is a startup in this area, uses. And we see that there is not much improvement based on that, because more of the aggregation and interference happens near the gateway nodes.
How is the channel
assignment
done in this case?
Just do an independent, essentially so actually go back to the previous slide. So this would be using one channel, and this would be using another channel, and so on. Each gateway is using a different each tree of the gateway is using a different channel.
I guess the question is the other node just arbitrarily assigned to gateway, or is there some load balancing there as well?
No, there is load balancing there as well.
And that's done how?
Yeah. No, I don't know how Tropos does that. No, that I do not know.
Plus, there might be more gateways in the vicinity than the number of channels and stuff.
Not for this experiment evaluation that I have done in general. Yeah, I have 4 gateways and I have 12 channels available.
Quick question about your down NIC. So if you're at the gateway, do you have more than one down NIC?
Yes, in general you can have that. And that actually makes sense, because you want to have more... I missed your question. Okay. No, you would not have any up NICs. So yes, you would have more down NICs if you are the gateway node.
Okay.
Correct.
Great.
Yeah. And in general, you can put more interfaces on the nodes which are closer to the gateway as compared to nodes which are farther, because you want to have more richer connectivity there. Okay. So if you do an identical channel assignment with 2 interfaces, you get 2 times improvement. And this is what the distributed channel assignment that I discussed gives us. It gives us 6 to 7 times improvement with the same set of hardware, essentially just putting 1 extra interface on every node. And there's a centralized channel assignment algorithm which I did not discuss, but that also gives similar improvement. So why do we get so much improvement? Essentially because we are, by using from 1 NIC to 2 NIC, there is a substantial improvement, because we are able to break the collision domains or the interference zones from and spread it across different channels. And or you can say that within a certain area, I'm able to use a lot more than 2 channels. And that's the essential reason I'm able to get so much improvement. Okay, so quickly about... these are the experiments I did with... So those were with more of CVR traffic, but these are with HTTP traffic. So here I have 64 nodes with 4 gateway nodes again. And each node is generating HTTP traffic, just like an ISP would be, just like a hotspot network would be generating. And the intensity is decided by a random number. And here we see that... So this is the intensity as I increase the amount of traffic which is imposed on the network, and on the y-axis is the average HTTP response time. So I'm able to reduce the significantly reduce the response time for the same intensity of traffic, as well as support a lot more users at saturation. So that's essentially what this is. And the same thing, I did a prototype implementation of the same thing. Here I had 9 nodes, 2 of which were connected to the department wired network. And they were all running Windows XP, and there were 2 802.11 ABG interfaces running in 802.11A mode. And there's a user level route and channel assignment daemon running on each node, which is running the protocol which I described with other nodes, and deciding the channels and setting the channels and using IP routing for doing the actual routing. So essentially I just set the IP routing tables, and IP routing takes care of it. And again I see that with 7 channels, I'm able to get something like 7 times five times improvement over a single channel case, had the testbed been operating in a single channel mode. And this result again matches with the NS2 simulation results of NST simulation of the same test bed.
Sorry.
Over, so I operated the test bed in two different modes. In one mode, I have the entire protocol running with two cards fully utilized. And in the other case, I'm just using one card on every node and assign it to the same channel all over.
That's not really fair, right? I mean, you're using one card for every node.
Yes.
And you're comparing that with two cards and one.
Correct. Yeah, ideally, that's not the fairest comparison. So there are two answers to that question. One is I can divide this 5 by 2 and say that I'm still getting 2.5 times improvement over the single channel case, over the single radio single channel case.
And every node is generating traffic in your case?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And the other, actually, just 1 second. So the other answer to that question is it's not even clear whether a single radio router makes sense fundamentally, given that I can actually, since I'm anyway setting up a node, I might as well put more routers, more nodes on, more interfaces on that end, come up with a richer network. Because the incremental cost of putting one interface is not, it's not going to double the cost of the entire node. So that's the other answer to your question. So, yeah. So actually, it's three questions. Okay.
In the single radio case, what was the diameter of the network in terms of hops?
1 to 9 or whatever. So this is essentially the topology. So 5 had to talk to 9 via 8.
Okay, so
these are the flows which I'm showing, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Did you by any chance try simulating this exact setup in the simulator?
Yeah, actually that's what I wrote. So I did the simulation of this same setup in the NS2 and it comes up with the same result. Okay. Oh, sorry, you have a question.
What if you put the same number of NICs as channels?
Same number of NICs as channels. Then you can use something like what you guys have proposed, actually. Jitu and Victor have proposed that you essentially, what you do is you assign channel 1 to interface 1, channel 2 to interface 2, and so on. And you form those many parallel networks in some sense. And all you have to do is, on every point, what you can do is, when I'm sending a packet, I will just choose the optimal link to send the packet over. So in that case also, I cannot get more than the number of channels times improvement. But I'm adding the hardware cost in that case.
So the main thing here is you have a constraint on the number of NICs. I mean, that's really what's constraining. It's not so much interference that's constraining things, right?
It's
a constraint on the amount of radios.
That is a major constraint, correct.
If you didn't constrain that, then if that weren't a constraint, you could put as many radios as channels, right?
Mm-hmm. Then the interference will become the main thing. I have to make sure that I transmit over the correct radio every time.
Would you get, in that case, let's say 7x? Improvement or more than a 7x improvement?
I will get 7x improvement. Yeah, but I have to put 7 cards on every node.
I think it's a scheduling problem at that point.
Yes. So the question is, do I want to put in that many cards to get this much improvement? The answer is, it's not necessary. Okay. Okay, so the second part of the... Actually, let's see, how much time do we have? We have till 3 o'clock. So let's see. I'm trying to figure out what's the best thing to discuss at this point. Okay.
I just have to let you know that I have to, unfortunately, this easy wordy, but I think we have room for another half an hour.
Half an hour. So maybe what I'll do is I'll just discuss the research issue and the basic things here, and then I'll move on to the testbed platform. That's probably a better idea, and we can discuss things in detail. Okay, so here the key problem that I'm addressing is that of utilization and fairness. So the utilization problem is that TCP, when we run it over mesh, it has been shown that it doesn't work very well. And there are two problems which happen. First is the amount of acknowledgement overhead which TCP imposes is substantially high. And secondly, TCP's congestion control gets triggered at wrong times. So here are numbers from some from a real testbed. What I have is two nodes, and they are just running a TCP flow as, and in another case, they are running a UDP flow, optimal UDP flow, where optimal is decided by sending data at different rates. And depending on the channel condition, which I varied by changing the transmit power and increasing the distance, etc., between them, when the channel conditions are bad, the amount of impact which TCP can have on the throughput can be substantially high. In the very worst case, it's actually this much. And even when the channel conditions are good, I see that there is approximately 20% degradation when you're using TCP, and that's because of the acknowledgement overhead. So acknowledgement imposes a lot more overhead when you're using 802.11, because per packet overhead in 802.11 is higher. So that's the first problem which you see, that that's a utilization of the available bandwidth. And second problem is, again, these numbers are based on the testbed results, and this is also this essentially is the problem of asymmetric contention and unfair channel sharing. Here the problem is that, let's go to problems one at a time. So here we have I'm talking about the well-known hidden node problem. And here node 1 doesn't know that node 1 is sending traffic to node 2 and 3 sending to 4, and node 1 is out of range of node 3. Now, what that ends up doing is node 1 tries at inopportune times and hence backs off because it is not responded well by the node 2. However, RTCTS does not solve this problem. What RTCTS does is it makes sure that once node 1 gets channel, then its communication would not be corrupted by node 3, but it does not ensure that node 1 ever gets the channel to begin with. And that's what we see in this case here. So here what I have is the same flows running TCP and two other ad hoc transport protocols, ATP and EXACT. EXACT is more of a congestion control. And the optimal, which has done using running different UDP flows at different rates. So they are far from optimal, as you can see. And the same thing happens, I won't go into the detail of this, is what happens here is when I have, in a wireless network, it may happen that flows are sharing the channel, although they are not sharing any node. So here, these three flows are sharing the same channel as this flow F4, but they're not sharing any node. What that ends up doing is, the aggregate throughput which these three get approximately equals the throughput which F4 gets, which is what we see in TCP here. And again, that's not necessarily optimal, just because based on my location in the network, I'm going to get different throughput. And these are the two problems which I look at, and this is what I propose to solve that problem. And again, this one, I'm just going to go over this slide, and I'm not going to discuss this in detail right now. So here, what I proposed is a stateful transport protocol. And what does stateful transport protocol mean? Each router in the wireless mesh network would maintain per flow information. It would maintain information such as what is the incoming rate and what is the estimated demand of the node, and does an explicit allocation of bandwidth across those flows, and informs this and sends this information back to the senders of the flows. And so that's what this explicit rate allocation based congestion control does. And then to alleviate the hidden node problem and arbitrary channel sharing space problem that I showed in previous slide, I have proposed a coordinated congestion control mechanism. Here, we essentially do a global allocation of bandwidth across flows. And by doing rate control, we are able to achieve much fairer allocation of bandwidth across flows. And this is how I... since this is a new transport protocol, we believe that the way it would work is that from the ingress, it would work in a split TCP fashion. Essentially, there would be a TCP connection from end user to all the way to the internet host, but it would be broken into three different connections, and that's what I've shown here. So I believe that this stateful transport protocol approach would work for a mesh network scale network, just because, first of all, the routers would probably be owned by the same ISP, and so they are more willing to exchange information between among each other. And secondly, we are not working at that high scale now, not as an internet scale. So, and the number of flows which we have to sustain per router may not be as high. So that's why that's where the motivation of improving the throughput of wireless mesh network by using a stateful transfer protocol comes from. Yes.
Can you explain briefly how this helps fix the problem of indefinite backoff that you mentioned in the previous
one? So that is what this congestion coordinate congestion control does, and. No, I'm not changing the existing. I'm just doing rate control at transport layer. So I'm limiting the amount of data which the sender of the inhibiting link can send. And that, along with RTS-CTS, essentially takes care of making sure that the original guy also gets some share.
Okay. In the scenario that we were focused on earlier, where you had a gateway node and a bunch of other nodes attached to that, there's this other problem, right? Also the parking lot problem, where the nodes closest to the gateway are getting an unfair share of the thing because they have to deal with the fact that the guys who are very far away and not. Admission control mechanism also take care of that?
So this explicit rate allocation and congestion control takes care of that as well. So that is the location of a node would not determine how much throughput it would get, how much bandwidth share it would get. Essentially, it is not RTT dependent anymore. So we have to go to the next part of the talk, but I'm ready to discuss these things on an individual basis. So let's skip all this. Let's go to the more interesting part. So this is the testbed part, which we recently got a paper in Mobisys about. And the problem here that we started tackling was that based on all our experiences, we figured out that doing mesh networking experiment is very hard. And why is it hard? Because I had to deploy a testbed. And I can't just put everything in the same room right now. I have to actually put nodes really far away from each other so that they can form a true multi-hop topology. Now, once I put these nodes far away, the problem doesn't stop at that because now I cannot move these nodes around. Because they're so far away, I have to actually go there and move them and stuff. So manageability and reconfigurability are two things which I'm looking for from an experimentation platform. The third thing I'm looking for from is some sort of controllability. I want to be able to move the nodes around and not just reconfigure topology, but also reconfigure software very easily. And thirdly, but all these things are there in simulation in some sense. But what is not there in simulation is the realism part. So I want to capture the realism as well while getting the advantages of simulator. And that's where we build this testbed from. So this testbed essentially is a you can call it, it's a miniaturized mobile ad hoc network testbed. So each node here is composed of this Roomba, which we use as the mobility platform. And on top of the Roomba, there is a small form factor PC router board, which sends IR signal via universal remote control that controls the movement of the Roomba. These are the four antennas, that is, there are four interfaces on every node, so we can do multi-radio experiments. And on top of it, there is a colored patch. The problem with Roomba is that once you move Roomba, then its positions, its movements are not very accurate. So we need to do some sort of tracking. So for that, we have put color patch and we have put a camera array on the top of the room. So at the end, what we have is this testbed, what you can do is you can visualize the entire testbed over the internet. You can see that you can see the positions of the nodes. You can move the nodes around. When you move a node, that sends a signal over the control interface, which sends it to the router board, which sends an IR signal to the Roomba, and the Roomba moves its location. Yeah.
How much are you going to bring up to make sure that this is fitment to multi-orbit?
I'm sorry.
How much attenuation are you going to?
Oh, how much attenuation are we doing? So each node has an attenuation of 23 dB, and it's operating in 802.11a mode.
How much attenuation what is the diameter of the network?
So the diameter of the network is, forgetting the exact numbers, but it's approximately half of this. In terms of hops, it's three hops. Yeah, so node here has to go over two hops to talk to the corner node. Okay, so essentially what we, so the things which are there are, first of all, we have full node mobility. Now every node can move around and we can control the position of the nodes. That's the first thing. Second thing we have is, so we can not only do topology reconfiguration, we can also do mobility-based experiments. And to support 24/7 operation, we utilize the fact that Roomba has this auto-docking feature. Now, since everything is battery-operated, nodes, the battery will die after some time. And we utilize this docking stations which are there at the corner. So essentially what we do is when we estimate how much the power level, remaining battery level is on every node, and when it falls below certain threshold, then we direct the Roomba to go back to this docking station, again as using automatic software. And that way the nodes remain fully charged, and essentially the testbed in its eventual vision can support 24/7 operations. And the key thing which Jitu just already mentioned is the miniaturization, which is that within this small room, we are able to support multiple hops. So miniaturization, mobility, and 24/7 operation. And then the final thing is that I want to be able to run my NS2 protocols and simulation scripts on top of the testbed. So what we have done is we have come up with this hybrid simulation environment where you can run an NS simulation on top of the testbed, and each virtual node of the NS2 gets mapped onto a physical node. And the packet traverses the original NS2 stack until when it reaches the MAC layer. At that time, we take the packet out of the NS2 and send it over the real wireless interface and bring it back to the other end. Yeah.
In doing this miniaturization within this room, have you lost certain properties of the network?
Yes. Essentially, it's not, you can call it, it's not as real as one would expect it to be. Because what we are doing is we are essentially taking only a part of the signal strength, part of the signal distribution, and capturing that here. We don't have the complete distribution.
And how bad do you think that is, like, with your impact results?
We have actually done a bunch of experiments comparing this with a larger scale testbed, and it does look like it's reasonably okay. Yeah.
So these are mounted on this robotic vacuum cleaners?
Yeah.
Not use one, but can you actually control the position of one of those?
In the manual mode you can. Yeah, in the automatic mode it does. Oh, sure. Yeah. In the automatic mode it goes wherever it wants to, but in the manual mode you can kind of say to it.
So you set the direction and speed and then it moves
that way? Yeah. Actually, there are only two movements you can do, two things you can do. You can ask it to rotate in one direction, or you can ask it to move certain steps.
So
yeah, that's it. Okay, so these are the, yeah, I've talked about all of them. So in hybrid simulation, we have also come up with other things like breakpointing of entire simulation and reverting the simulation to a certain point based on snapshotting. And okay, so that's about Mint. And to conclude the talk before we go on to other questions, started with the vision of truly wireless enterprise networks, and tried to expand the role of 802.11 beyond access point to mobile communication, and specifically come up with a bunch of techniques for improving the throughput and the fairness of flows going through a mesh network. And first is the multi-channel mesh networking, which improves the capacity by using multiple radios and thereby multiple channels. And I have proposed a stateful transfer protocol, which we did not get a chance to discuss, but that improves the fairness and utilization of the network. And finally, as an experimentation platform, we have devised this autonomic reconfigurable testbed, which features miniaturization, mobility, and hybrid simulation. Okay, so Actually, maybe we should go to the... So some of the future work which I have come up with based on my understanding of how things are is that one of the things which one of the trends which we are seeing is that mesh networks are increasingly being deployed at larger and larger scales. And once you go to a sort of a city-wide scale, mesh networks can become increasingly really big. And second trend which you can see is that mesh routers are becoming more and more complex. You're going to have more and more cross-layer optimizations, and you'll put multiple radios, and they will use MIMOs. And what this would do is it would, all this complexity would make the manageability of mesh networks extremely hard. And the way I see it is that this overall network management of such large-scale wireless mesh networks is a promising problem to address. And that's something which I plan to look at. And there are several research topics which come out of this, something such as from an administrator standpoint, I want to get an entire view, get a unified view of the entire network. I want to see where the nodes are and how the channels are utilized, whether the protocol is operating correctly or not. Then fault diagnosis of such mesh networks would be another problem. Then stateful transport protocol, stateful protocol design is something which I have explored at the transport protocol layer here, and it can be the approach can be carried on to other layers as well. And then fault tolerant mesh protocol design is another problem to look at. So I concluded the talk a little earlier so that we have enough time for questions. Okay. So John, you had a question, and is that answered or not answered?
It wasn't a good question, so.
No, no. I see. Yes.
I have a question. On the capacity problem, do you think the problem is solved? Or, I mean, in the sense, like, I was trying to gauge the fact, you compared your system to the baseline. How much more scope for improvement is there? Do you have a sense of that? Like, if I were to do things differently, make
yes.
different decisions?
Uh-huh.
There might be.
Yeah, so that's one thing which I ideally would have wanted to look at, but frankly speaking, I had to send out my paper, so I did not. You know, I did not look at that very carefully as to. But there is a lot of work which is already going on in this direction as to what is the optimal throughput of, what is the optimal performance of a multi-radio wireless mesh network, and so people are looking at that actually.
Well, all right. Thank the speaker.
Okay.
All right.
Okay.